الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم ما بعد. Continuing on with our درس in the book على سلو ستة من شيخ محمد بن عبد الوهاب رحمه الله تعالى, we came to the third fundamental. And to briefly recap what we've already discussed and what we've already covered, bi'idhnillah ta'ala, was the first two principles, and the first principle being ikhlas lillah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that we are sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our worship of Him and Him alone, and that all of our actions and all of our deeds are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second principle, or the second fundamental, the Shaykh mentioned, which is taken from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that the amr bi ijtima' wa nahi an tafarraq, meaning that the command to come together, to have unity, and the prohibition of dividing. And we discussed in detail about this very important foundation in the religion, this fundamental principle, and that Islam calls us from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be unified as one community, as one ummah, as the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that Islam, in accordance with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded us as well, is not to divide, not to divide into groups and the sects. And so these very important foundations, they form, as he says, the Shaykh said, usul sitta, that these are the fundamentals of the Islamic religion. And these are important fundamentals that many people, and even those people who are considered people of knowledge, have, some of them, have missed these important foundations and actually call to the exact opposite of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded and what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has commanded. And in fact, not only do they contradict, but often they oppose these very important principles, or they may have a nux in their understanding. Some of them have a misunderstand these very important foundations, which are established from the Quran and the Sunnah. So moving on to the third principle, which is a very, very important fundamental, which we'll talk about, and we will also try to be brief and maybe only deal with only this asul, or this asul min those six fundamentals, in order to make sure, because of the time difference, that we don't contradict or disrupt the schedules of those people who are listening from, you know, outside of Saudi Arabia. And so, coming to the third asl, al-asl al-thalith, as-sam'u wa-ta'a, the third fundamental is hearing and obeying. And so we're going to emphasize some very important principles which are taken from the scholars of Islam, both classical and the contemporary scholars, especially Sheikh Muhammad Aman Ajami, rahimahullah ta'ala, regarding this very important principle, and that the need for this principle and to understand this principle is even more apparent in this time, in the fact that we have many things going on in the Muslim world, and more specifically in the Arab world, in many of the countries where there are rebellions and revolutions that have taken place within a very short period of time. This tension has been building, and there has been oppression, and there has been a very quick reaction, and often, or in some cases, very violent reaction, like what we see in Yemen and Libya, especially more specifically Libya. And so we see that there is a need for returning back to the book and the sunnah to understand these contemporary issues. So the Shaykh began, he said, al-asla thalith, إن من تمام الاجتماع السمع والطاعة لمن تأمر علينا ولو كان عبدا حبشيا. So the Sheikh said that without a doubt, what illustrates complete unity is hearing and obeying whoever has been placed in authority over us. Even if he were an Ethiopian slave. So the Sheikh began to mention this third principle by taking a part of a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which we will get to very shortly, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that hearing and obeying is a part of the Islamic religion. So this is a part of this foundation, that we should hear and obey the Muslim leader, even if the leader were an Ethiopian slave, meaning someone who did not have great status in the society, and people did not see this person as particularly a person of status and position, but however they, in whatever capacity, they became the leader of the Muslims in that country, or the Khalifa, the leader of the Muslims everywhere, that they should be listened to and obeyed. And they should be listened to and obeyed in righteousness, meaning that if we are commanded to do that which is prohibited by the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, we should not follow them in that disobedience. The Sheikh mentioned, Sheikh Muhammad Aman Jami, rahimahullah ta'ala, in his ta'likat, or in his explanation of this principle. He said it was mentioned in the second fundamental that Allah ordered unity in the religion and prohibited division. And the obligation of unity was already discussed, and the impermissibility of separation. In addition, division contradicts the spirit of Islam, which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stated in a hadith, "Verily Allah is pleased with three things for you: to worship Allah alone and not associate any partners with Him; to hold to the rope of Allah altogether and not divide; and that you advise the leader." So this is an authentic hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was Sheikh al-Albani declared it sahih in his silsila as-sahiha. And this hadith illustrates that from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with these three things for us as a community, is that we do not commit shirk, that we worship Allah alone, and that we hold on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala altogether and do not divide, and that you advise the leader, meaning the leader of the Muslims. And those three things that are mentioned in that hadith are actually go in accordance with the first three principles of this treatise we're studying. Because the first thing that was mentioned, verily Allah is pleased with you three things. To worship Allah alone and not associate partners with Him. That's ikhlas, and that's the first principle that we've already taken. To hold to the rope of Allah together and not divide. That's the second principle, is that we have the ijtima, is that we are unified as a community. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not pleased that we divided into groups and sects. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, and hold fast together, all of you, and to the rope of Allah, and do not divide. So Allah has commanded us. That's the second principle. And then the third principle, which is the shahid here, is the main point of mentioning this hadith, is the principle that we are taking now, the sami' wa ta', is hearing and obeying the leader. And that was what the Prophet ﷺ said, and that you advise the leader. And as is explained in another hadith, is that advice, when we advise the leader, is that we advise the leader behind closed doors. We do not get on the minbar. We do not do it in the marketplace, yelling and cursing the leader, and in gatherings and so forth where the leader is not even present, or there's no way that it will even reach the leader, we do not consider that advice for the leader, that we curse them and we speak about them and talk about their mistakes in those gatherings, because there's no benefit. That only creates a disunity between the leader and those people who are ruled by the leader. And the Salaf used to consider that a type of khuruj, or a type of rebellion, meaning that there's a rebellion by the sword and there's a rebellion by the tongue, and we'll explain that even further as we cover this foundation. So it is from the foundation of Islam to hear and obey the Muslim ruler. And this is illustrated all throughout the books of the creed from the Salaf. So in the books of Aqidah, the early books, you'll find that they always referred to this as a foundation. And they referred to this issue of leadership, of listening and obeying the Muslim leader. This is, you'll find all throughout the early books of Aqidah, that this is a very important point, because it was a it was an early issue in the early days of Islam, during the time of the Sahaba, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that the Khawarij first appeared. And so with the appearance of a group who held in their belief and in their practice, both, in their belief, they believed, they used to make takfir of the Sahaba. They considered them apostates, and that they believed that they did not rule by the book and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And so they rebelled against them. So they considered that rebellion as a way of amr bin ma'ruf wa nahi al munkar, as a way of commanding the good and forbidding the evil. This is what the Khawarij held as a belief. And so they fought Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and they were responsible for the killing of Uthman and Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. And so this is from that time up until today that we find in the books of the Salaf that they referred to this very important point due to that fact that that was a fitna that they dealt with, and a fitna that would be with us up until the Day of Judgment, that the Khawarij and those people who have similar beliefs to them would exist in this community. So the Shaykh went on to say, then unity cannot be attained, nor straight leadership or religion, except by hearing and obeying. Therefore, hearing and obeying whoever rules over us is considered one of the obligations of Islam. So regardless of race, nationality, position, or status of the person who has attained authority, he must be obeyed in righteousness. And this is irrespective of whether he is an oppressive leader or righteous one, as long as he remains Muslim. So that is the very, very important point. The Khawarij, what they believed, is they made takfir of the people. So if the person made a major sin, or made a mistake in leadership, they just declared them outright a disbeliever, because they believed that iman, or faith, was either complete, or that faith was non-existent. They didn't believe there was no room for anything in between. They believed either you're a perfect believer, or you're not a believer at all. So with that, they believed that rebelling against the oppressive leader, because of course if someone is oppression, is an oppressive tyrant, that means this is also, they're illustrating that they have weak iman. They have weak faith. Why? Because oppression, that contradicts Islam. You know, being an oppressive tyrant, taking people's rights, oppressing people, harming people, torturing people, taking their wealth. All of this is ways in which a person exhibits weak faith. So the Khawarij, therefore, then said, hey, that person's no longer a Muslim. However, Ahlus Sunnah believes that even if a person is an oppressive leader, then they're still Muslim, and they still have the right to be listened to and obeyed, except in those commands, which are commands to disobedience. So, for example, if a leader is an oppressive leader, and they order you to take riba, to take usury, you know, from a bank, then it is upon you as a Muslim in that country to not obey them in taking the riba, and taking this interest. Because that contradicts your what Allah and His Messenger, Allah makes war on the person who takes riba. And the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that the person who takes riba and the person who signs the contract and the person who witnesses it are all the same. They are all, cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah will make war upon them. So, therefore, it would not be permissible to obey the leader in that command. And this goes with anyone, that there's no obedience to in disobedience to Allah. La ta'bi ma'siyati khalik. That there is no obedience in disobedience to the Creator of the heavens and earth. So, and in this regard, the Prophet ﷺ said, I advise you to fear Allah. Alaykum bi sami wa ta'a. Oh, alaykum bi taqwallah wa sami wa ta'a. In abdin habashiyan. Faman يعيش منكم بعدي فسيرى اختلافا كثيرا وعليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين عدوا عليها بالنواذج وإياكم ومحدثات الأمور فإن كل بدعة ضلالة. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I advise you to fear Allah and hear and obey, even if the leader was an Ethiopian slave. So whoever lives after me will see many differences. فَسَيَرَىٰ إِخْتَلَافًا كَثِيرًا. And then he gives us the prescription. Therefore, it is upon you my sunnah. And the sunnah of the rightly guided Khalifat, cling to it with your molar teeth. And beware innovated matters, for verily every innovation is a bid'ah, and every bid'ah is misguidance. So this is what the Prophet ﷺ ordered us with. He ordered us to hear and obey the leader, even if the leader were an Ethiopian slave. And he said that whoever lives after me will see many differences. Isn't that the case with now? We see many differences. And he says, therefore it is upon you my sunnah and the sunnah of the rightly guided Khalifat, meaning Abu Bakr, wa Umar, wa Uthman, wa Ali, radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een. It's upon us their sunnah, the sunnah of the Prophet and their sunnah, and that we should cling to it with our molar teeth. And our molar teeth are the teeth that are in the back of our mouth. So that shows us that when that is a full clinging onto, that is a full biting. When you bite on something with your molar teeth, with the back of your mouth, that means you are fully clinging to it. So the Prophet ﷺ made that tashbih. He made that resemblance to clinging to the sunnah, to clinging with your molar teeth. And then he said, and beware innovated matters, meaning bid'ah, and every innovation is a bid'ah, and every bid'ah is misguidance. So there's no good bid'ah. Do not listen to those people who say, oh, there's a good bid'ah. There's a bid'ah hasanah, meaning there is something good that is not within the fold of Islam, but that we can take it and add it to our worship, or detract from our worship. No, that the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is complete. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's religion is complete. And every bid'ah, as the Prophet ﷺ, kullu bid'atin dalala. He said every bid'ah is misguidance. Then the Prophet ﷺ made this matter clear, to be obedient to the leader. And he made it understood and sufficient in various ways, legislatively and through divine decree. So all throughout the Quran and the Sunnah, we see that it urges us to, and makes clear for us, the point of holding to and being obedient to the commands of the Muslim leader. That this is a foundation of the religion. The Sunnah explains this. And all the verses in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to follow illustrate this very important point. Then this fundamental became unknown amongst some of those who claim to have knowledge. So how can it be practiced, or how can it be acted upon? If the people that adhere to knowledge, or that people take them as people who are knowledgeable in their community, do not believe in this important principle, that they encourage the youth, encourage the people to rebel against the leaders. They say, no, 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 no. If the imam of your masjid is giving the khutbah and telling you should make protest in the street for Egypt, protest for Libya, protest in your support for the people in Yemen. If they're telling you this and they're not practicing it, then how can it be acted upon? When in fact those things are contradicting what the Prophet ﷺ has ordered us to do. Nowhere will you find in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, nowhere will you find in the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nowhere will you find from the Salaf as-Saleh, because that's what we're concerned with. We're concerned with following the classical scholars, not with someone here today who says, oh, it's okay, I'm giving you a fatwa, it's okay, make protests in downtown in support of the brothers in Libya. No, you won't find this. Or make protests in Saudi Arabia, or make protests in this country. You will not find this from Kitab wa Sunnah. And this is what we're concerned with, because we're Muslim. We're not Democrats. We're not Republicans. We're not Freemasons. No, our religion is based on Kitab wa Sunnah. So if you are being, if you are, hatu burhanakum in kuntum sadiqeen, if you're being truthful, give your proof. Give your proof from where? From Kitabillah wa Sunnatul Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not from Bill Clinton. Not from Tony Blair. Not from Bush. Not from Obama. No. No, we don't care about Sarah Palin, what she says about Libya. We care about what Kitabillah wa Sunnatul Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what those principles which are established from the Quran and the Sunnah and the Fahm as-Salaf as-Saleh. This is what we're concerned about on how to practice these things. So when you hear people making fatwa based on batil, that are telling you to make protests, and protest this, and let's get the Egyptians together and the Libyans together to protest this, know that that has nothing to do with Islam. So the Shaykh went on to say, if knowledge itself is lost, then practicing it is completely out of the question. Perhaps some people understand that hearing and obey is an obligation only if the leader is knowledgeable and just. Then a person should be obedient and take the pledge of allegiance to him and listen to him. If the matter is other than that, then there is no obedience in hearing or pledge to them. The Shaykh went on to say, this is one of the widespread mistakes people make today. Meaning that they only think you should only be obedient to the leaders if he's perfect. If he's perfectly practicing the Quran and the Sunnah. Or if he's doing things which are in accordance with your desires. He's being as democratic as possible, he's legislating this law away from the Sharia, and this law contradicts the Sharia, but it goes with your desires. Then you believe it's okay to be obedient to him. But if he makes a mistake, you say no, there's no bay'ah to him. There's no no pledge of allegiance to him, and there's no obedience to him. No, this is a khata, as the Shaykh says, Shaykh Muhammad Aman Ajami, rahimahullah ta'ala, is pointing out, this is a mistake, and this is the tariq, this is the path of the way the Khawarij understand, that either it's perfect obedience or there's none at all. Absolutely not. And this is what you see the modern day takfiris, they say the same thing. They say, hey, that the leader has this mistake, he does this sin in this country, he did this sin, we saw him wearing this, and he was doing these major sins. Yes, they're major sins. And we don't follow them in major sins, and nor do we defend them in major sins. But we are concerned with, does that take them out of the fold of Islam or not? And is this something that the ulama, the scholars, the major scholars of Islam who have knowledge about these issues educate, or is it for you, the mainstream Muslim, to make these principles and make these judgments upon the leaders of whether we should follow them or not? No. We go back to the scholars, and we go back to the education from the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is a widespread mistake that people make today. It is a mistake in accordance to the Sharia and the intellect. The Shaykh said, it's a mistake in accordance to what? To the Sharia, meaning the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and the intellect, meaning a sound intellect. So whoever Allah bestows a healthy intellect upon will understand the issue in its reality. And it shows he possesses understanding of the history of our pious predecessors and an understanding of the religion. Therefore, as long as the leader does not possess open disbelief meaning undisputable disbelief, which he exhibits openly, advertising it and propagating it, and it does not include hidden disbelief that he is unaware of. An example of this is the leader who calls to abandoning the prayer. then his disbelief is clear, and he has announced it. Likewise, if he commanded the society to leave fasting, and these are real situations where we've had leaders in the past, like one of the previous, not the one who's now in Saudi Arabia, Zain Abidine or whatever his name is, the former president of Tunis, but the one before him. He said he made a fatwa, and he made his mufti get on television and say, hey, because it's going to harm productivity, I'm giving you a fatwa that you do not have to fast Ramadan. And he ate on television during Ramadan. And this is well known and documented. Okay? So Sheikh Muhammad Aman Ajami, rahimahullah ta'ala, is making ishara, he's making the point, and making this point related to that particular leader. So he says, likewise, if he commanded the society to leave fasting Ramadan because they might become weak in productivity, then this is advertising disbelief. This is open disbelief, open kufr. He's advertising it. Matter of fact, he went on television and ate on national television. Therefore, he is a disbeliever, and there is no obedience to him or hearing or pledge of allegiance. Another point that needs to be made up here, as Sheikh Abdulaziz bin Baz, rahimahullah ta'ala, had mentioned in one of his treatises about the conditions for when it is permissible to rebel against a leader. We're not going to spend much time on that issue. We want to stick with what we are more specifically in our subject. But I just want to make ishara here, is that the Sheikh mentioned that there are certain conditions for rebelling against the leader. So even when we have the case of Saddam Hussein, for example, that many of the scholars of Ahl Sunnah in that time made takfir of him because he was a leader of Hizb al-Ba'ath. He was a leader of a communist party which believed in the party above the religion. That, you know, Islam had no importance. He was believed in, it's Hizb al-Ba'ath al-Arabi or whatever they're called, that they are in the Arabic, they were a nationalist, communist, or socialist party. So they put nationalism and communism before Islam. You know, that's what they ruled by. So the scholars had made takfir of him, but they did not urge their people to rebel against him. You don't have fatwa of Sheikh Mukbil or Sheikh bin Baz or many other major scholars of our time who urged the people to rebel because the people didn't have the ability to do so. So one of the conditions for, even if the leader had left the fold of Islam, one of the conditions for rebelling against him would be that you have the ability to do so, meaning you have the ability to be successful, that there's a, you know, there's an overwhelming sense that you will be successful in that, and so that it will, and that you will not harm, you know, it will not be causing a great and excessive harm to the Muslim, to loss of Muslim life and property. And the beautiful, unfortunately, I don't say beautiful, but what illustrates this point totally is what actually happened in Iraq, is that they didn't rebel against the leader, but the non-Muslims invaded Iraq and they removed Saddam Hussein. And up until now, 10 years later, the people of Iraq are still suffering. Still there's bloodshed. And invited those other takfiri extremists, like Zarqawi and other people, to cause blowing up people and blowing up the women and cutting out people's tongues and so forth. Then it incited the Shia. The Shia are killing American soldiers. They're killing Ahl Sunnah. They're killing these people. They're killing, you know, it's just killing and bloodshed. And then the American troops are killing and bombing people, bombing civilians and bombing these people and bombing, you know, it's just fulva. It is nothing but chaos. So this is what we see is the natija. This is the result of that when you remove the leader. Also, look at what's going on in Libya. So they decided, this is an exact situation. They decided to revolt, and what is it? They don't have the ability to remove that oppressive tyrant, disbeliever, Gaddafi, who the ulama have made takfir of because of his distortion, his so-called little red book and our green book and other things which he has opened kufr, but they did not have the ability. And that's why they had to call the NATO and other people to come in and bomb, and they still don't have the ability because they're not giving them enough support to where they can do the job. So look at the fitna, because the people of Libya are the ones who ultimately suffer.
So this is why one of the mafasid, one of the harms of when people rebel against a leader. So the Shaykh went on to say that hearing in the Pledge of Allegiance, he said, this is what the companions of the Prophet ﷺ were upon. They prayed behind Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. They prayed behind Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, who was an oppressive Muslim tyrant. Hajjaj was an oppressive Muslim tyrant that killed companions of the Prophet ﷺ, radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in. So Hajjaj was killing the companions. How much more is that as a major sin and something evil and oppressive? But however, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ still used to pray behind him, this evil tyrant. They didn't rebel against him. Imam Malik said, the last of the ummah will not be rectified except by what the first of it was rectified. Meaning, this is a very famous statement of Imam Malik. He said, لا يصلح آخر هذه الأمة إلا بما صلح به أولها. He said that the last of the ummah, meaning which is what we live in this time, will not be rectified except by what the first of it was rectified for. So when the people tell you that, hey, we need to protest, we need to rebel, we need to have a Facebook protest, and we need to do this and we need to do that, tell them that no, let's rectify our situation by returning the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and how the Salaf al-Saleh understood the religion. If we return to how they will, we'll have Allah's help. Because it doesn't matter. Mark Zuckerman cannot help you with the Facebook rebellions. Even though it toppled this government and it helped as a means to topple those governments, that you and I need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help. Sheikh Muhammad Aman Ajami states, they were rectified, when he explained this affair of Imam Malik, he said they were rectified by unifying, avoiding division, hearing and obeying, and avoiding revolt. This is how the classical scholars and the Sahaba and the Tabi'een, with Tabi'a Tabi'een, this is how they rectified their situation. By unifying and avoiding division and hearing and obeying the leader and avoiding revolution and revolt. Revolt can be by the sword and the tongue. And this was understood by the Salaf. As for today, we see revolution in Tunisia, Egypt, Libya, and Yemen, among other places. And we cannot begin to account for the loss of lives and properties in places like Yemen and Libya. This is not taking into account places like Iraq and Afghanistan, which lost the disbelieving tyrant Saddam, as we've already mentioned, but at what cost to the Iraqi people and instability worldwide? All the mafasid worldwide in the region cannot be underestimated from trying to topple one person and not replacing him with that which is better. It's still not stable in that country, and the Iraqi people are still the ones suffering. The Prophet ﷺ said, obey the one who will be given the bay'ah, the pledge, first. Fulfill their rights, for Allah will ask them about any shortcomings in ruling over their subjects whom Allah has placed under them. So Allah is going to ask the leaders about how they ruled over you. But obey them. The Prophet ﷺ, obey them. He said, Allah will ask them about their shortcomings. The Prophet ﷺ said regarding the ruler, obey him as long as he obeys Allah, and disobey him if he disobeys Allah. Meaning, the disobedient to the ruler is only in matters which the ruler commanded disobedience to Allah. As for other commands issued by the ruler, even if he was a tyrant, he should be obeyed, and this is the understanding of the Orthodox creed. This is the understanding of the Salaf al-Saleh. Is that we do not totally deny obedience to an oppressive tyrant ruler. This is one that we're talking about, one who still remains Muslim. And even if the non-Muslim authority over you, for example, for us who live in the West, that they, those laws and those things which they order us to do, which are in agreeance with the Quran and the Sunnah, we have to obey. Why? Because you're obeying Allah's command. So if they tell us, you know, that it's impermissible to kill, it's impermissible to steal, we have to be obedient in that. We can't say, no, I'm living in this land, and I'm living in this land, he's not a Muslim, I can be disobedient. No, you cannot rob and kill and steal. That's prohibited in Islam. So you should obey in those commands. because those are commands that agree with the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet ﷺ said, a ruler of the Muslims is a shield for them. They fight behind him and they are protected by him. If he enjoins fear of Allah, the exalted and glorious, and dispenses justice, there will be a reward for him. And if he enjoins otherwise, he will receive its consequences. These are all, if you just read Sahih Muslim, go to the chapter Bab al-Imara, the chapter of leadership in Sahih Muslim, you'll find more than I counted, I believe it was 102 hadiths or possibly more. I can't remember, it's been a while. But there's that many hadiths saying that we should hear and obey the leader. But why is it these takfiris, these neo-takfiris still don't get it and still call the people to rebel? وَعِيَاذٍ بِاللَّهِ May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them or erase them from our presence to keep from causing fitna for the Muslims everywhere and even the non-Muslims. This shows that according to the Prophet ﷺ, the leader is held accountable in the hereafter. And it is not for his subjects to rebel due to dissatisfaction or oppression. The Prophet ﷺ said, no obedience is due when it involves disobeying Allah. And obedience is only in what Allah loves and all that Islam ordains. So obedience is only in matters deemed lawful by Islam. And if the leader has open sins, he should not be fought. One of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ asked the Prophet ﷺ if they should fight the sinful, oppressive leaders. Listen to what the Prophet ﷺ said. This is an incredibly important hadith which you'll find in Sahih Muslim. You'll find it in Sahih Muslim. Go to Sahih Muslim. SubhanAllah. So they asked, the companions asked the Prophet ﷺ if they should fight the sinful, oppressive leader. Isn't this exactly what those takfiris are calling? This is what the people, they call him Sheikh Faisal. This is what he said. He said, rebel against the leader, Abu Hamza Misri. He said, rebel against the leader, Abu Qatada Filistini. He said, rebel against the leader. And amongst those who are, you know, only have Arabic fatwa, Abu Muhammad Filistini, or he's in Jordan, and he and others like him, these people make fatwa and say rebel against the oppressive leader. How many people will you see on the minbar and in their lectures talking about rebelling against the leader? But let's see what the Prophet ﷺ said when he was asked about that. If you need a fatwa, go back to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and see what he said. One of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ asked the Prophet ﷺ if they should fight who? The sinful, oppressive leaders by the sword. This is what they asked. He ﷺ replied, no, as long as they observe the prayers. And if you notice your rulers doing a hateful thing, hate what they do, but never quit obeying them. La ilaha illallah. That's what the Prophet ﷺ said. Isn't that sufficient for you? Or you still need a fatwa? You still need to rebel? You still need to see blood spilled? You still need to make protests? You still need to have secret gatherings and call the people to boycott and disobey the leader? La ilaha illa ant subhanaka inni kuntu min adh-dhalimin. That's sufficient what the Prophet ﷺ said. It's sufficient to know that rebelling against the leader is impermissible, and that this goes against the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And there is so much, return to Sahih Muslim, and you'll find ample evidence regarding this very important matter. And so since we were able to finish that, those are the main points I wanted to make, I think we can quickly go through the next fundamental. Or in fact, maybe we will leave it. We'll leave it, inshallah ta'ala, for the next sitting, so that way we're not just in a hurry. But we can't illustrate enough that this very important point, which is the third point, which is hearing and obeying the leader. That hearing and obeying the leader, that regardless of it, whether they are an Ethiopian slave, as the Prophet described, regardless of whether the leader was an oppressive tyrant, as the Prophet ﷺ was asked in a hadith related in that's narrated in Sahih Muslim. For example, the Prophet ﷺ said, "Alaykum bi sami wa ta'a, على سمي وطال مرى المسلم فيما يحب وكره ما لن يؤمر بمعصية فإذا أمر بمعصية فلا سمع ولا طاعة. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that hearing and obey the leader in that which you like and that which you detest, as long as he orders you to do righteousness and not that which is sinful and disobedient. Because if he orders you with disobedience to Allah, then there is no hearing and obeying in that matter. The Prophet ﷺ said there's no hearing and obeying. And what we learn from looking at the evidences of the Kitab Allah wa Sunnah of Rasul ﷺ, this refers to that particular manner. It doesn't mean that the leader makes a mistake or the leader is sinful and that you just totally become disobedient to him. No, because then no one would be obeyed. For example, even this is with the haq of the husband over his wife, that he should be listened and obeyed as long as he's calling her to righteousness. But if he calls her to do something sinful, for example, the husband says, no, you don't pray. I don't like when you wear hijab, don't wear hijab. But Allah is commanding you to wear hijab. The Prophet ﷺ sunnah and the way the believing women practice, they wore hijab, they covered their faces, they covered themselves. But if your husband is disobedient, he says, no, I don't like you to cover, as some men that are fasiks do this, then there's no obedience in that. You cannot obey him in that because he's calling you to be disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the wife cannot obey him in that. But does that mean she should totally not obey him ever and no longer listen to him? No. Unless he becomes a disbeliever. And as some of the scholars in Islam believe that leaving the salat, for example, the person who leaves the salat is a disbeliever. So if the husband quits praying, then they say that the wife, in a sense, should get a khula, that she's no longer should be married to this person because he is a disbeliever. And this is the qawl of many of the scholars in Islam, that this person should not be is no longer obeyed. But if the leader or the husband or the person who's charged in authority, that they have made a mistake, or they have some sins, or some oppression, or even a lot of oppression, but as long as they're still keeping the salat, in the case of the leader, and in all of their cases, they're still commanding the salat and establishing the prayer, then they should still be obeyed, as long as they are still Muslim. So they should still be obeyed. Not obeyed in that sinful command, but obeyed in general. So this is the main point with this bab, with this point, and just as a quick, brief review, that the first from the six Asul al-Sitta, this treatise, which is a very important treatise relating to creed, the first principle is what? Is that we should have sincerity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our worship. Our worship goes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and we are away from shirk. And the second principle is that we do not divide. As the Prophet ﷺ said, اِفْتَرَكَتِ الْيَهُودَ لَيْتَ وَسَبْعِينَ فِرْقَ وَافْتَرَكَتِ النَّصَارَى لَيْتَ نَتَيْنَ وَسَبْعِينَ فِرْقَ وَسَتَفْتَرِكُ هَذِهِ أُمَّةَ لَتَرَاثَ وَسَبْعِينَ فِرْقَ. The Prophet ﷺ said, this community would divide into 73 sects, all of them in the fire except one. And they said, who are they, Ya Rasulullah? He said, those that are on my sunnah and the sunnah of my companions. So this shows us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us with that second foundation, which is to be unified as one community. And this last principle that we took today, this third foundation, which is what? Is that we listen and obey the leader. Because listening and obey the leader helps us and is the completeness of those other principles. All of these have ample evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the classical scholars of Islam. And I ask Allah the Almighty to accept our good and forgive our evil. And anything that I said that was correct was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anything that I said that was incorrect was from myself and the shaitan. And inshallah ta'ala, our next lecture will continue on with the next three foundations. وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.